morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our Wednesday morning's devotion on this second week in our Lenten season. Our readings for today are Genesis 37, 25 to 36, Mark 1, 29 to 45. The Psalm is number 119, verses 49 to 72. The Collect is for the first week in Lent. I trust that all is well, even under our present condition. Please join us in our opening hymn. Service continues from page 33 in our Book of Common Prayer with the opening sentence for Lent, and we continue from page 35. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Continue in prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer your worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. To your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Divinity. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands molded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he himself is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. If only you will hear his voice today, for he comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with his truth. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We continue as we bring before the Lord or those things for which even our consciences are afraid, as we seek his forgiveness. Let us now approach God's throne of mercy with reverence in humble supplication. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our appointed psalm is 119, Psalm 119, verses 49 to 72. Psalm 119, 49 to 72. Remember your word to your servant, because you have given me hope. This is my comfort in my trouble, that your promise gives me life. The proud have derided me cruelly, but I have not turned away from your law. When I remember your judgments of old, O Lord, I take great comfort. I am filled with a burning rage because of the wicked who forsake your law. Your statutes have been like songs to me wherever I have lived as a stranger. I remember your name in the night, O Lord. I dwell upon your law. This is how it has been with me because I have kept your commandments. You only are my portion, O Lord. I have promised to keep your word. I entreat you with all my heart, and to keep your commandments. Though the cords of the wicked entangle me, I do not forget your law. At midnight, I will rise and give you thanks because of your righteous judgment. I am a companion of all who fear you and of those who keep your commandments. The earth, O Lord, is full of your love. Instruct me in your statutes. O Lord, you have dealt graciously with your servant according to your word. Teach me discernment and knowledge, for I have believed in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good, and you bring forth good. Instruct me in your statutes. The proud have smeared me with lies, but I keep your commandments with my whole heart. Their heart is gross and fat, but my delight is in your law. It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is dear to me, than is more dear to me than thousands in gold and silver. The word of the Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, shall be forever. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 37, begin at verse 25. A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Genesis, chapter 37, beginning at verse 25 and on to 36. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead, with their camels carrying gum, balm, and raisin on their way to carry down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. When some Midianites traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. When Reuben returned to the pit and saw that Joseph was not in the pit, he tore his clothes. He returned to his brothers and said, "The boy is gone, and I, where can I turn?" Then they took Joseph's robe, slaughtered a goat, and dipped the robe in the blood. They had the long robe with sleeves taken to their father, and they said, "This we found. See now whether it is your son's robe or not." He recognized it and said, "It is my son's robe. A wild animal has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his garments and put sackcloth on his loins and mourned for his son many days. All his sons and all his daughters sought to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted and said, "No, I shall go down to Sheol to my son mourning." Thus his father bewailed him. Meanwhile, the Midianites had sold him into Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. We continue with the Benedictus, found on page 40 of your Book of Common Prayer. The Benedictus. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel. You have come to your people and set them free. You have raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of your servant David. Through your holy prophets, you promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our forebears and to remember your holy covenant. This was the oath you swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship you without fear, holy and righteous before you, all the days of our life. A new child shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way, to give God's people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine upon those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet in the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We go to our second reading, a reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, beginning at verse 29 and on to 45. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening, at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he could not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went toward Galilee, proclaiming the message in the synagogue and casting out demons. A leper came to him, begging him, and kneeling, he said to him, "If you choose, you can make me clean." Moved with pity, Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, "I do choose, be made clean." Immediately the leprosy left him and he was made clean. After sternly warning him, he sent him away at once, saying to him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer for your cleansing what Moses commanded as a testimony to them." But he went out and began to proclaim it freely and to spread the word. So Jesus could no longer go into the town openly, but stayed out in the country, and the people came to him from every quarter. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so, my friends, I'm grateful for the opportunity to share with you my thoughts on this morning's gospel reading. I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In our gospel reading today, we can discern clear strategies in dealing with ministry and dealing with the issues we encounter. We are also enlightened on the awesome power of Jesus over the elements of evil. We find Jesus engaged in his great Galilean ministry, and we should notice at once a level of urgency as he proceeds. His purposefulness is inescapable. At the synagogue in Capernaum, Jesus had taught with such authority that he astounded his listeners. He further asserted his authority by cleansing a man of unclean spirit and commanded the spirits to be silent. This was a new type of authority he displayed, teaching unlike the religious authority of the day, with their repetitive rhetoric, devoid of comfort and saving grace, intended only to further enslave the minds of the people. Jesus, leaving the synagogue, went to the house of Simon and Andrew. He was accompanied by James and John. There he found Simon's mother-in-law laid up in bed with a fever. Jesus was informed of her condition as he arrived. The apostles and all present knew that when Jesus came, when Jesus appears, he comes only to do good. And we must feel just as strongly about invoking the presence of Jesus to revive us in our needs. When we need healing, in whatever way, we must feel just as eager as the apostles to invoke the presence of Christ into our situation. And where we fall down miserably is due to our lack of faith and our impatience. We must remember that there's much to learn during a period of illness. If only we could look beyond the pain, if only we could look beyond the discomfort, if we could look beyond the suffering, the disablement, if only we could look past those things and look to Jesus for healing, then we would fare better. One commentator even says on this subject, he contends that those who kept from public audiences by sickness or other hindrances may expect the Savior's gracious presence, but this is only if we let him in. So Jesus took the sick by the hand and lifted her up. She was cured of her fever to the extent that she began to serve those present. Such was and still is the nature of Christ. When he heals completely. The prophet Jeremiah declared, "Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved. For you are my praise." Psalm 41 advises, "The Lord sustains them on their sickbed and ministers them in their illness." My friends, such is the nature of Christ Jesus. The scripture relates that evening, as the sun receded, all who were sick of many diseases or demon-possessed were brought to him. The people of the city gathered around the door and they experienced his power of deliverance from the variety of diseases, including demonic possession. Again, Jesus did not allow the demons to identify him, because they are aware of his divinity and that they were confronted by the power of God. And Jesus prevented them from identifying. You see, the devil must have no say in the agenda of God and have no say in the revelation of his Son. And this revelation of his Son would be done in God's own time. And so the demons were restricted from speaking. After an eventful night of healing, casting out demons, and the restoration of the broken, Jesus went early in the morning to a deserted area to pray. Here, Jesus is demonstrating to us and guiding us towards the importance of prayer and rejuvenation through prayer. Jesus looked to the Father for reviving him, for rejuvenating his strength to continue his ministry. Psalm 18, verse 32 declares, "It is God who guides me about with strength, who girds me about with strength, and makes my way secure." My friends, those who are involved in healing are very aware of the draining of energy and the need to fortify oneself by fervent prayers. It is a lifestyle of prayer which sustains ministry. It sustains the healing, the preaching, and the teaching ministry of our Lord. And we cannot dare to go without it. We therefore are guided to follow where Jesus leads. Jesus never lost focus, for in his mind and in his hectic schedule, to take time for private prayer. Simon and the others had to search for Christ on the morning. Upon locating him, they informed him that the people were searching for him. But Jesus didn't return to the city, but took his disciples into the surrounding towns to proclaim the good news there also, explaining that it was for this purpose he had come. And this is something we need to note about Jesus. He never lost focus of what he was sent to do. He explained to them that this is the purpose for which he had come. Far too often we involved in ministry lose focus and tend to drift off into doing things that we had not intended to do. His moving onto the neighboring towns was driven by his divine guidance. He had spent the early morning, while it was still dark, in prayer. No doubt, seeking to know the Father's will for him. And we must also find time to seek, to try and find out what is the Father's will for us. Jesus had probably saw through the shallowness of the popularity in Capernaum. And he took the opportunity to teach his disciples by example, turning his back or moving away from the town and moving into the country. His emphasis was on preaching the word, while using the healing ministry to bring relief to those suffering. And so it was, Jesus journeyed through Galilee, proclaiming the good news in the synagogue and delivering many from the grasp of demonic power. The scripture says that a leper came to him, begging him and kneeling. And we have to note here the earnest desperation and the reverence of this leper. He said to Jesus, "If you choose, you can make me clean." The leper made no demands, but submitted himself totally to the will of the master. Additionally, he expressed belief and confidence in the ability of the Savior to restore him. Notice his choice of words. He was sure that the Savior could heal him. Sometimes, my friends, we fail to receive healing because we do not truly believe. But Jesus made it clear on so many occasions that it requires belief in his healing power if healing is to take place. And as the scripture unfolds, it says, "Moved with pity, Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him. He said, 'I do choose, be made clean.' Immediately, the leprosy left him and he was made clean." In this cleansing, Jesus totally disregarded the culture and health issues of the day. Under the law, a person who is touches a leper becomes unclean, ceremonial clean. That is in Leviticus 13. And there was a danger also of contracting the disease. Jesus, however, totally dismissed any any issues regarding this. He then instructed the former leper. He forbade him from publicizing his healing, but he must show himself to the priest to make a cleansing offering as required under the law. We must note here that in spite of Jesus' authority, he never disregarded the proper law of the day, which required the leper to go and show himself to the priest. So Jesus did not just make him clean. He reminded him that, listen, you must go and show yourself to the priest. Told him also, do not publicize his healing. The man, however, could not contain himself, and he went abroad publicizing his healing to such an extent that Jesus was hindered from continuing his public work in that town. He could no longer pursue his public ministry in the town. Jesus then retired to the country district, where the people came to him from every region. So Jesus did not allow being unable to continue preaching in the town to jeopardize his ministry. He simply refocused and deployed a new strategy. Remember, he was going about preaching before. Now he allowed the people to come to him. Far too often, we allow unforeseen issues to severely hamper us in our ministerial effort. But we must deploy other strategies to obtain the desired effect. Also coming out of this, we can see clearly that Jesus did not measure his success by the popularity he gained in the town. He, however, made the best of whatever opportunity was presented to him. He could no longer preach in the town. He retired to the country district to continue his work. It did not matter to him if he worked in the town or in the country district, as long as he continued doing the work his Father had sent him to do. And so it must be for us. All who are involved with ministry must place their focus on the Word and not on the surroundings. The mission involves making disciples of all nations, also teaching them to obey everything that the Lord commanded, regardless. So may God grant us his grace to do so as ministers of his word. The Lord be with you.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best. Seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when it seems of glory, sing the new, new song. Twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. To tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love.
Let us now confess our faith as we pray together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so we continue. And by way of intercession, we pray for God's abundant blessing and mercy on his people. Today, we continue to pray for world peace. We pray that wars will cease and that love will increase. We pray against that war in Ukraine, between the people of Ukraine and Russia. We pray that it does not escalate and develop into anything worse than it is. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for those so seriously dispossessed. We pray that even in the face of this mayhem, we see where discrimination is raising its ugly head. We pray against this. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We pray for the Anglican Church worldwide, for the well-being of the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Justin Welby. We pray also for the well-being of our provisional Archbishop, the Most Reverend Howard Gregory. We pray for the blessings of God to descend on our own diocesan bishop, the Right Reverend Claude Berkeley. We pray for healing for his dear wife, for the comfort of his family. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We pray for the continued assistance and the well-being of the retired bishops, Calvin, Roland, Clive, that God will continue to bless them and strengthen them as they assist in his vineyard. Lord, in your mercy, Please hear our prayer. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, today we pray for the St. Andrew's Church in Coover. We pray for the, as the bishop gives oversight, we pray for the Reverend Winston Roberts. We also pray for the diploma in pastoral studies and the diocesan program. We pray for the Institute of Pastoral Care for Codrington College. We pray for the United Theological College of the West Indies. We pray for all seminarians and lay evangelists. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. In our own parish, we continue to pray for our parish priests, Reverend Father Professor Anderson Maxwell. Pray also for his dear wife and for his family. We pray for those who assist Reverend Father Titus Akbarali and his family, Reverend Pontifex Andre, priest, and her family. We pray for the well-being of the families and of the deacons, Finley and Fanfare. Pray for all lay evangelists and lay ministers and all those who assist in carrying forward the ministry in this parish. Remembering also our former rector, Canon Gemma Hazelwood, that God will bless him in his golden years. We continue to bring to our God the congregation of this parish at Overpoon, at St. Philip's, at the Church of the Transfiguration Maloney, at St. Aidan's and St. Mary's, praying that as we open up to normal attendance, that we'll be guided to observe the various protocols, that we do nothing that will cause a spread of the virus. We pray also that God will put a hand in our affairs and guide us along as we proceed forward. Continue to pray for our citizens abroad as they return home. We pray for those who are sick, and we pray that they will use this special time to draw closer to God, to look beyond their various illnesses and look to the sustainer of life. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. Remembering those who have passed, and pray that God would grant them his rest. We continue with our intercessions. We go to suffrage A on page 43 of your Book of Common Prayer. Lord, reveal your love among us that we may know the joy of your salvation. Grant peace within and among all nations, and teach your leaders wisdom. Endow your church with faithfulness, and your servants with knowledge and true godliness. Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed, that your justice may be known among all people. Lord, renew your spirit within us, that in us and through us, your will be done. Amen. Our collect is for the first Sunday in Lent, found on page 163 of your Book of Common Prayer. Collect for the first Sunday in Lent. Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us, who are assaulted by many transgressions, and as you know, the weakness of each of us, Let us each find you mighty to save through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue on page 45. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the rest of the past night and for the gift of a new day with its opportunities of pleasing you. Grant that we may so pass its hours in perfect freedom of your service, that at evening we may again give you thanks through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, a strength to our lives. Please take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so, my brothers and sisters, our devotion for this morning has come to an end. We look forward to the opening up of the church once more. But we must be to open up the church once more fully. But we must come out understanding that we are not over this virus, and we should observe the protocols that are in place. Let us now go in peace to serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.